Good evening, everyone. It's good to have you here this evening, and it's indeed an evening of joy and celebration. As I talked to some of the seniors this afternoon, I said, what song would you like to sing this evening to kind of start things off? And it was a busy day, and they were setting up, and they said, you pick the song. Anybody associated with Fairview Christian School knows there's a song that probably we have sung more than any other song over the years. As I thought about what I should lead, I thought, why not bookend this program with our theme, which is Found Faithful? And it's in the heart of every senior and every believer tonight to be someday truly home, to live a life of faithfulness. So we're going to sing, You May Have a Fancy Car, Brand New House That Shines By Far. And if you know this song, join me in singing it. You may have a fancy car, brand new house that shines by far. You may live to be 100 years old, but if you have not been saved, it all ends with a grave. But I want us to be together in heaven. I want us to be together in heaven. I want to walk down the streets of pure gold. I want to run through the fields of green clover, see the mansions, smell the flowers, hear the singing, it's all ours. See the river gently flowing, feel the gentle breezes blowing. I want us to be together in heaven. You may be a millionaire wearing clothes. You may have the best that money can buy, but if the blood is not applied, then in hell you'll lift your eyes. But I want us to be together in heaven. I want us to be together in heaven. I want to walk down the streets of pure gold. I want to run through the fields of green clover. See the mansion, smell the flowers, hear the singing, it's all ours. See the river gently flowing, feel the gentle breezes blowing. I want us to be together in heaven. Amen.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our graduation ceremony. On behalf of the class of 2023, I would like to thank all family members, friends, and loved ones for your support and encouragement to us. Without all of that, we wouldn't be where we are today. I would also like to thank the Fairview Christian School teachers and staff for all your principles, patience, and hard work that you have put into us, that made us grow in knowledge and character, and made us who we are. To the class of 2023, we made it. This is a big chapter of our lives that is closing. School is a lot of hard work and time, but we have persevered and we have made it. As we start a new chapter in our lives, let us not forget the lessons we have learned in school. May we continue instead to continue in God's will and follow God and continue in his will for our lives, and let us be found faithful. At this time, I would like to turn this opportunity over to Daryl Petersheim to give us the commencement address.
Well, good evening. It is a privilege and an honor to be here, to be part of this ceremony, this celebration for the class of 23. Wow, hard to believe we're in 23, and it makes it all the more special to be part of this with my daughter Chrissy being part of the class. It's a good-looking class, I must say. You're a very good-looking bunch, and I do think my daughter probably bump that average on the beauty level up a little bit, but she has an even more beautiful heart. So it's an honor to be asked to do this. I will do my best to be found faithful tonight as I share. I was thinking about this for a few months. Chrissy came to me a few months ago and asked if I would share something here at the graduation, and told me their theme was found faithful. Found faithful was a good thing for me to meditate on. What does found faithful mean? Last week I was at a Turkey Hill. I pulled up to the gas pump and started filling my truck with fuel, and the guy across the pump from me was pumping his fuel. It was one of these beautiful mornings, and I said, "Hello, sir, good morning." And he said, "Good morning." And I said, "It's a beautiful day out, isn't it?" He's like, "Yeah, I could take this weather year round." Beautiful day. We finished filling our vehicles, and he was filling a van there that had an advertisement on the side that said something about workout equipment. He was selling workout equipment, had a cartoon character of a guy lifting weights, and finished filling our tanks, and he said, "Have a good day," and we were on our way. And as I drove down the road, I was thinking to myself, that must be the most faithful man that I ever met. I had never seen him before. I didn't know him from Adam. But as I thought about how friendly he was, and anybody that sells workout equipment's got to be dedicated, right? So that must be the most faithful man I ever met. Now, before you think I'm going off the deep end, what's wrong with that picture? The second half of the story, by the way, was not true. But why wouldn't you think that he's the most faithful man I ever met? What is missing from a picture of faithfulness in that story? One of the primary components of faithfulness is time. Faithfulness requires time. You know, if I would have went to that Turkey Hill every day for 10 years and said, this guy was the friendliest man I ever met every day that I see him there, maybe then I could say he's the most faithful man I ever met. But without time, it's hard to really call somebody or something faithful. So I was thinking about this theme that the class chose, found faithful. I'm not sure why they put it way over on that side of the gym. I think your theme should have been set apart or something. But found faithful, what does the word found imply? Why not say declared faithful? Is that the same? If you think of somebody in court being found guilty or declared guilty, what's the difference? Found would imply to me something of testing or of trying. There's a proving period and a cross-examining maybe where someone has proved whatever the outcome, and in this case, found faithful. So as I meditated on this little theme that they chose, found faithful to me means testing over time. Testing over time. Now, you have taken a lot of tests over the past 12 years. I don't know how many tests, any idea how many that would be, but I'm sure you're probably to the point tonight where you're like, I'm done with tests. The tests are over. Let's get on with life. I'm free, right? I'm free. Speaking of found faithful, Randy Alcorn says, a long obedience in the same direction, sustained by the small choices we make each day. We need to be acutely aware of the cumulative nature of our little choices. I like that, the long obedience in the same direction. When I think of faithfulness, a long obedience in the same direction, and it's the small choices we do every day that cumulate to the point where we can be called faithful. You have been faithful students for 12 years. That's why you're here tonight. And so we want to celebrate that. So I asked Chrissy just a couple weeks ago, I was like, you know what? You didn't give me a verse. What verse did you choose to go along with found faithful? There's a lot of scriptures that talk about being faithful. One that comes to my mind was one of those verses in the bottom of the page when I was in elementary school, says, moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. But she said, no, we were trying to think of one that had something to do with faithfulness, and they came up with Revelation 2:10. Revelation 2:10 says, do not fear any of those things which you are about to suffer. Is that like after you get out of school? I think you're feeling like you're going to be done suffering after tonight, maybe, but do not fear any of those things which you are about to suffer. Indeed, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested, and you will have tribulation 10 days, 12 years in your case. Be faithful until death, and I will give you the crown of life. Or tonight, it's the diploma is your reward if you're faithful for 12 years. But that verse there's four things I see in that verse that give us some marks of the faithful. Marks of the faithful that I see in Revelation 2:10. The first one is, the faithful do not fall to fear. The faithful do not fall to fear. Now, I noticed in your yearbook, it says, do not fear any of those things which you're about to suffer, Revelation 2:10. But as I was looking at the favorite verses you guys chose in your class, two of you chose the same one. Gibson, I believe, and Violet, you both chose Isaiah 41:10. It says, fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. A lot of the verses you chose talk about fear. And Emily chose one that says, let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Lewis, I believe it was. No, it was Benji that chose Philippians 3:14. I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. So between fear and faithfulness, you all chose verses that kind of go along with this theme as well. So fear is a real part of life. But the faithful do not fall into fear. There's going to be things that come along the way that cause our hearts to fear. But the faithful don't fall to fear. The second thing I see in Revelation 2:10, the marks of the faithful are tested over time. The faithful are tested over time. Now, I work in, we install sewer and water lines, and when you test a water line, you pump it up to, say, 200 PSI, 200 pounds of pressure is the test. And it's not only a poundage or a PSI that you're looking for in the test, it's also a length of time. So most specs will say you got to pump it up to 200 pounds for 2 hours. It's not like you run the pump up and get it up. Okay, we hit the 200-pound mark. Okay, you're good to go. No, it's a test over time. It's 2 hours it has to hold before you can say it's passed the test. So the faithful are tested over time. The third one I see in Revelation 2:10, it says, be faithful until death. The faithful endure to the end. The faithful endure to the end. Jesus said in Matthew that when, and you can see a picture here of testing as well, then you will be arrested, persecuted, and killed. You will be hated all over the world because you are my followers. And many will turn away from me and betray and hate each other. And many false prophets will appear and will deceive many people. Sin will be rampant everywhere, and the love of many will grow cold. But he who endures to the end will be saved. The faithful endure to the end. The fourth mark of the faithful that I see in Revelation 2:10 is the faithful receive the reward. The faithful receive the reward. It says, be faithful until death, and I will give you the crown of life. Now, I'm sure you had some students that joined your class along the way. By the way, how many of you were in class for all 4 years of high school? All of you except, okay. Not everybody has their hand up now. So it's all of you were all together through high school. Okay. Did you have anybody else join your class for a while and then leave or drop out? Okay, I don't have any names that come to mind, but whoever they were, if they were in your class in 10th grade or 11th grade, they may have even had the best grades in your class. They may have been the smartest person, but they're not here tonight, right? They're not here tonight. The faithful endure to the end, and it's the faithful that receive the reward. You guys are the ones that have endured to the end and the ones that are receiving the diploma tonight. So testing over time to be found faithful. I remember in the sixth grade, I think it was, when I was about to take state history. Now, up until that point, I was taking all the paces. All my subjects would come in the form of these little booklets. But state history was going to be a textbook that you had to read and be tested out of. And it made me nervous, and people were saying how hard state history was. It's a really tough course. And so I was studying for my first test and wondering how hard this test was going to be. And when I got to test day and the teacher gave me the test, I couldn't believe what I was seeing. At the top of the paper, there was five blanks. And it said, list the names of five counties in Pennsylvania. And I was like, oh, this is supposed to be hard? This is hard? Well, it was probably the most simple test I ever took, yet those were probably the weightiest questions that I ever had on a test. If you think about it, if there's only five questions on a test and you get one wrong, what does that give you? An 80%? You get two wrong, you flunk the test. So I'm thinking, wow, this is a really simple test, but I'm like, oh, Berks County, I know that, Bucks and Chester. But then I was like, you know what? I got to make sure I get these last two right. I don't want to do something dumb here. You mess up on one little question, you flunk the test. So that it was a simple test, but very weighty questions with just three. And when I think of being tested over time, I think of Peter. Peter gives us an example in the Bible of what a test for faithfulness looks like. So, and if you think testing is behind you tonight, by the way, you got a lot coming. It's just starting. There's a test in life almost daily. You're tested with something, and you're going to keep learning as well. as you go from this stage of your life. But in John 13, we have the story of Jesus being in the upper room and he's talking with his disciples, and Judas leaves to go betray Jesus. And Jesus tells his disciples, "Soon I'm going to go away. It's just a little while and I'll be leaving you. And where I'm going, you can't go with me." And Peter said, "Well, I will die for you. I will go with you till the death. There's nowhere you can go that I won't go with you. Count me in." And we don't have recorded that any of the other disciples said that. That was just Peter. So if I were Jesus, I might have said, "Well, Peter, you are my most faithful disciple. Nobody else said that they would go with me to the death. You're my most faithful disciple." But instead, Jesus gave Peter a test with some very simple questions, but they were very weighty questions. The questions came just a few hours later when Jesus was at the house of the high priest and Peter was waiting outside the door. And the first question came through a damsel. The young servant girl came and said, "You aren't one of this man's disciples, are you?" Peter said, "Oh, no, I'm not. I'm not one of his disciples, no." And so she led him on into the fire where there were some other people warming themselves. And he comes up to the fire and he's sitting around there a while. And one of the guys looks over and says, You're not one of his disciples, are you?" Peter says, No, I'm not a disciple. I don't know the guy." And after a while, somebody else comes over to the fire. It was the high priest's servant. He was actually a relative of the guy that Peter cut his ear off. And he comes over and says, "Hey, didn't I see you in the garden with Jesus?" And Peter says, "I don't know the man. I don't know this guy." And at that moment, the Bible says, the rooster began to crow. Now, did you ever have a timer in school when you were being tested? I remember achievement tests, they use timers. I don't know if they use timers otherwise. But I don't remember a timer that sounded like a rooster when it was up. But here, Jesus gave Peter a test with some very simple questions. And he gave him a test with a timer and said, "Peter, before the rooster crows, you're going to deny me 3 times. And at that moment, when Peter said the third time that he doesn't know Jesus, the timer expired. I wonder how Peter felt at that moment. How many of you over the past 12 years have failed a test? Be honest, okay? Everybody except Emily? No, she's good. Okay. So you failed it. What are you doing here then if you failed a test? How did you make it to graduation? If you failed a test, what happened next? After you failed a test, what happened next? What did your teacher do? Can you give me any feedback? What was policy if you failed a test? Study and try again. Okay, you must have merciful teachers. Well, Jesus was a very merciful teacher. Matter of fact, in 2 Timothy, it says about God, if we are unfaithful, he remains faithful. He cannot deny who he is. And so Jesus, being the faithful one that he is, he gave Peter a retest. And after he had resurrected and he came back and the disciples were out on the water fishing, this is the third time he showed up, and they see him on the shore and they come in and he has breakfast cooking for them. Peter comes and I'm sure he was feeling about this big. And when they realized it was Jesus, Jesus gave him another test with 3 questions. And he said, "Peter, do you love me more than these?" Now, some would wonder if Jesus was referring to the fish that they caught or the other disciples. I guess I would have in my mind that he was referring maybe to the other disciples. And Peter, you're the guy that said you would go with me to the death. Do you claim to love me more than these? Peter said, "Yes, you know that I love you." Well, then I don't know if Jesus was being a little bit sarcastic there, maybe referring to the other disciples, but the next time he asks, he just says, "Do you love me?" Peter says, "Yes, you know that I love you." And then the third time, Jesus asked him again. He says, "Peter, do you love me?" Peter says, "Yes, Master, you know that I love you." And he was hurt by the fact that Jesus asked him three times. But it seems like Jesus was trying to get this point across to Peter to stop with the comparisons. Stop with the comparisons. Don't worry about everybody else. Don't act like you got it all figured out or you're the faithful one. Just be faithful to what I'm asking of you. And some people look at this passage and look at the emphasis on love, and there's two different words for love being used here. But I wonder if Jesus was actually emphasizing the pronouns in this question, simply saying, "Peter, do you love me? Do you love me? Don't worry about all these other guys." Now, Peter, I think he had ADHD. I don't know. He was the problem student and the guy that just never seemed to get it. And Jesus was driving this point home with him. Do you love me? Don't worry about everybody else. Matter of fact, Jesus gave him a harder test. He told him what his end would be. It says in John 21, "Very truly," this is Jesus talking to Peter, "very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go." Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, "Follow me." Now, basically what Jesus told Peter there is, "You're going to be crucified just like I was. Do you still want to follow me?" And what do you think Peter's response was? I think Jesus, remember, Jesus is trying to get the point across here, not to worry about everybody else, but this is between you and me. And Peter looks at Jesus and says, then he looks over at John, says, "What about him? What about him?" Now, if I'd have been Jesus, I think I would have lost it then, but I don't think Jesus lost it. But Jesus says, "What is that to you? What is that to you?" Did you ever do that to your fellow students in class? "Well, he gets to go outside early for break," or "What about him?" Or, "I'm getting in trouble for this. What about Lewis?" Or, "What about Jevin?" Who was the problem student in this class? I don't know. Worrying about somebody else. What is that to you? I want to add a second part to our title this evening. Found faithful, what is that to you? I want to ask you that question tonight as we think about you entering into the next phase of life, students. To be found faithful, what is that to you? What if God calls Violet to serve in the White House the next phase of her life, and God calls Eddie to work in the sewer? Don't worry, it's not that bad, but I wish. Or what is that to you? Does that matter? Does that have any bearing on whether you're faithful or not? Faithfulness requires a focus on self, a minding of my own business, or could I say a minding of my Father's business? Faithfulness has nothing to do with what's required of somebody else. It's not dependent on somebody else's actions or responses. It's not dependent on my circumstances. It's not dependent on how skilled or how talented I am or how intelligent I am. It doesn't even depend on how much I accomplish. Matter of fact, it's just those little things, that long obedience through life, accumulating, doing those little choices every day. You were taught in school to check off your goals every day, to daily check your goals. That is what being faithful is. To be found faithful, there's another thing that you need to know, is you must know your master and know what he's asking. Know what he's asking of you. Like I said, it doesn't matter how much you accomplish. What matters is if you're... Brother Fox, there he is. I don't know if he's able to stand, but Brother Fox, why don't we give Brother Fox some honor tonight? Brother Fox tells the story of how when he was grew up in Lancaster County and he was called to Reading, Reading was the last place he wanted to go. But I wonder if Brother Fox went around and knocked on all the farmers' doors and said, you know what? God called me to Reading. It's time for us to move. And knocked on all the neighbors' doors. If he did that, he didn't ever include it in the story that he told. But I don't think he did. Brother Fox felt the call on his life to go to Reading. Brother Fox felt the call on his life to start a school. It didn't matter what everybody else around him was doing. That's what God called him to do. And that's what faithfulness looks like. Brother Fox wasn't called to teach home ec or chemistry or algebra. Or did Brother Fox actually ever teach an academic class? Does anybody know? I don't think he did, that I know of. But Brother Fox was faithful to do what God called him to do and enabled the opportunity for all the other teachers and people that came here to do what God called them to do. Be faithful to what God has called you to do, and don't worry about everybody else. What is that to you? And Brother Fox, you will always have a soft place in my heart, in part because you allowed me to date one of the school teachers while simultaneously being part of the class of 97. So, anyway, that's just another example of what makes this school so extraordinary, right? So, I better get back to my notes here. Luke 12 says, the servant who knows the master's will and does not get ready or does not do what the master wants will be beaten with many blows, but the one who does not know and does things deserving punishment will be beaten with few blows. From everyone who has been given much, much will be demanded, and from the one who has been entrusted with much, much more will be asked. Class of 23, you have been given much. You have been entrusted with much. The teachers over the years here have poured out their lives for you. They have taught you the Bible. They have taught you the ways of God. They've taught you how to live. They've shown you by example. You've had a great group of friends to interact with. You've been given much, but much will be required. To be found faithful, what is that to you? I'd like to read yet one of my favorite passages in the Bible. From Hebrews 11, and I want us to think about this as we read the end of the faith chapter, it's called. Which one of these will be you? Maybe you don't know. Think about being tested over time. And the faith chapter talks about Abel and Enoch and Noah and Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Moses, but we get down towards the end of the chapter. In verse 32, it says, and what more shall I say? I do not have time to tell about Gideon, Barak, Samson, and Jephthah, about David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned into strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Women received back their dead, raised to life again. If that's a picture of the faithful, I'm in, right? Count me in. There were others who were tortured, refusing to be released so that they might gain an even better resurrection. Some faced jeers and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were put to death by stoning. They were sawed in two. They were killed by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and mountains, living in caves and in holes in the ground. These were all commended for their faith, or could I say faithfulness? It's faith, it's their faithfulness that they are commended for. It doesn't say these were all commended for their heroism or for their intelligence or for their skills or for what level of diploma they got. These were commended for their faithfulness. Which one of these will be you? Which one of you will be asked to take in an orphan or a widow? Which one of you will be asked to feed the hungry, or to start a school, or maybe just to be a kind neighbor? These were all commended for their faith. My wife and I had the privilege to go over to Israel last October and saw many moving sights over there. But I think the most moving to me was walking across the floor of some of those outdoor theaters and also standing on the floor of the prison where Paul was held before they shipped him to Rome when he appealed to Caesar, and seeing the foundation around there and just being in that place. There was something deep in my soul, a sense of awe, a sense of honor, of, you know, I've been to Mount Rushmore, I've been to the Washington Monument, and I've been to the Lincoln Memorial, but nothing gave me that sense in deep within my soul like it did walking across the floor of those theaters and thinking, these are those that were faithful. These are the ones that did not fall to fear. These are the ones that were tested over time. These are the ones that endured to the end. And these are the ones that received the reward. Will you be counted in that number? Class of 22. Will you be part of those who have been found faithful? Anyone that knows me knows I'm always up for a good play on words. And Rodney Griffin wrote a song that I was listening to recently that says, when this life is o'er and the next one's begun, I want it to start with well done. Amen. Is that your desire tonight? If nothing else, I want you to have the desire to endure to the end and be found faithful. There's no greater reward than to hear those words, well done, thou good and faithful servant. So much greater than a diploma. I don't want to belittle the diplomas tonight. You have a nice graduation party going on here. It's fun. You deserve it. You did a lot of hard work. But I want to say that this is nothing compared to the reward that's awaiting the faithful. It's good to be intelligent. It's good to be gifted. This whole class has a lot of giftings that I've seen over the years. It's been awesome to watch you play sports and sing and do all those things. But it's faithfulness that passes the test. It's faithfulness that is rewarded in the end. So you're about to go into the world for more testing. Will you be like Peter on his first test? Or will you, after you take the retest, also be counted in among the faithful as Peter? Your timers have been set. Before the rooster crows, will you be found faithful? I'd like to read your chosen passage here before I close again yet. Revelation 2:10, it says, do not fear any of those things which you are about to suffer. Indeed, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested, and you will have tribulation 10 days. Be faithful until death, and I will give you the crown of life. Found faithful, what is that to you? Let's pray. Father, we just thank you for your faithfulness, and you are so worthy of us following you. We want to be faithful to you, and I just pray a special blessing on this class of 23 here at Fairview Christian School, that they would remain faithful till the end. They have been faithful school students. They are being rewarded tonight for their diligence, but I pray that they would not lose heart, but continue to steadfastly follow you. Pray that you give them strength. Thank you for the promise that you will be with them and help us to all be faithful until we receive the crown of life. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you, Dad, for that. Well, good evening, and thank you all for coming. Because you're here, it means that you made an impact on one of us, or all of us, if you're a teacher. You made an impact on our lives in some way, and for that, we're so grateful, and it's so exciting to have all of you guys in one place to celebrate our graduation. I've been going to Fairview Christian School since second grade, and I've made countless, so many good memories. For 10 years, this has been my life. Life revolves around school. I mean, it's just like a summer vacation, and then you start school, and then you're just counting down the days till summer vacation. And then when you're in summer vacation, you're counting down the days till school. It just is a cycle. And so it's hard for me to believe that it's all coming to an end tonight. And I'm ready, but a little scared. And I'm excited, but also really sad. I'm dreaming of what God may have for me in the future, but also treasuring what life God has already given me here at Fairview Christian School. As I was thinking about writing and rewriting this speech, probably the person who knows me better than anyone else told me that she wants to hear what I learned at school. So since my big sister's advice rarely fails me, I guess that'll be my speech tonight. So it's hard for me to recognize things, though, without recognizing also the people who taught them to me. So Mr. Shirk taught me that loving God and loving others is the most important thing that I could ever accomplish in life. Mr. Horst taught me to think for myself and make my faith my own, which was extremely important to me and I am forever grateful for, because I have never always been good at thinking for myself and I just kind of go along with things. So it's so important that I learned that and I'm so grateful for that. Mr. Gaiman taught me how to love learning no matter how difficult the subject. I mean, he made chemistry interesting. That is hard to accomplish, so I appreciate that. Coach Joanna taught me that my team is everything. No one can win without a team. We lost together and we won together. And that's what matters. You can't win by yourself. And so when one of your teammates is hurting, the team hurts. And so you win and you lose together. My mom listened to hours of me reciting Bible verses, laying aside literally anything to help me study, showing me that nothing can benefit me more than memorizing God's word. And quizzing was my thing. I loved it. I loved quizzing. I just felt so at home with the people, and it was just a privilege to share what I had learned with others at retreats. And even when I felt like quitting, just because it was a lot of work, my mom was always there to encourage me. My dad taught me, through example, the value of waking up an hour earlier than anyone else, earlier than the sun, to spend time with God in preparation for the day. Dad, that's what got me through school. I'm sorry. Those moments with coffee and you and God, I couldn't have done school without that. I learned to laugh from my brother Jacob. even when life sucks and there are bad days, I am telling you, he still found something to laugh at. And You know, sometimes I knew that he was mad at someone or had something frustrating going on, but then I would see him making a joke with that same person the next moment, and I didn't even have to see him laughing. You can just hear him laugh, and it'll make you laugh. I learned to keep going no matter what is going on currently, what lies ahead, or what assignment is due at 12 o'clock, to just take the next step from my sister Whitney. Overall, I learned that school is more than facts. It's more than getting the diploma at the end. It's more than volleyball medals and passing grades. It's about my heart. So am I ready to be an adult and take responsibility and take care of myself? Probably not. Anyone who knows me knows I have a lot to learn. But I love Jesus, and I have made him my own, and I know that that's what my school is values and what is important to them. I'm ready to follow him no matter what, no matter where he takes me. And so thank you, every teacher, parent, family, and friend who has taught me that. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Today is the result of a lot of hard work accomplished. Thank you to everyone who has brought us to this point. I want to first thank my parents for always supporting me and being there for me. Thank you, Mom, for always coming to my school events, and Dad for listening to me talk about school and helping me find books for PCL assignments. I love you, Mom and Dad. Thank you to each of the teachers who have taught me over the last 13 years here at Fairview. Thank you for investing in my life. I have so many good memories and important lessons that I will always remember. I want to thank the high school teachers specifically. Thank you, Mr. Fox, for all the work you do to keep our high school running. Many people have been taught by Mr. Fox, but I believe it's only my class that can say we've been through his Zoom classes. That was an experience. We also had Mr. Horse our first 2 years of high school, as well as for PCL junior and senior year. Thank you, Mr. Horst, as Chrissy said, for making us think. Thank you to Mr. Shirk for really caring about our lives and being intentional about investing in us personally. Mr. Marcus, I've sat through many of your classes over the years, learning English, state history, writing, finances, health, current events, church history, and of course, Bible. Sometimes it felt like we covered all those topics in one class period. Thank you, Mr. Marcus, for the influence you've been on this school, on my class, and on me personally. Now I want to thank Mr. Gaiman and Ms. Camille. I spent my high school experience with my older siblings as teachers. Not many people can say that, and I wouldn't wish that on them. I'm just kidding. I don't think I could have accomplished all I did without their help. They've been my biggest fans and my role models for a long time. Thank you, Caleb, for being patient with me, for encouraging me, and for helping me with physics a lot this year. Thank you, Camille, for being the person I could talk to about anything, for helping me with Spanish, and for being my best friend. I love you both. Each year in high school, I've had a word of the year. My word for this year was success. I think of some advice that Mr. Chris gave us seniors a couple months ago. He said that when you do hard things, it shows you who you really are, and it forces you to grow. For a long time, I've had a quote hanging in my desk from the book Do Hard Things by Alex and Brett Harris. It goes like this: if we are willing to strive for excellence, even in the boring, repetitive tasks and responsibilities, we will reap powerful benefits that others miss. I believe that success comes when we attempt hard things. But what if we fail? This year I've learned that success is not obtaining perfection, but rather it's persevering through failure and coming out a better person. Success doesn't require you to never make mistakes. You will make mistakes. Success requires you to never quit. Success is not defined by perfection, but rather by perseverance. Now, the world will tell you what it is worthwhile to succeed at. People say to achieve things like wealth or fame or beauty, then you will have success. And it's true, it takes a lot of hard work to get those things. That is success. But the thing is that success is temporary. And there's a kind of success that's eternal. Joshua 1:8 says, "This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success." In Matthew 16:25, Jesus says, "For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it." Eternal success is defined not by how much you can gain for yourself, but by how much you can give of yourself to God and to others. There's a short story written by Lucy Maud Montgomery. It's called "The Brother Who Failed." It's about a family gathering for Christmas. The children are all grown up, and they're very successful. They've done well for themselves. One owns a railroad, another is a famous singer, another a lawyer. One is a wealthy farmer, and one is a university president. And then there's Robert, the brother who failed. He's just a poor farmer. He had never left their hometown, he was not rich or famous, and he had never done anything extraordinary. He was the black sheep of the family. But when gathered together, each sibling shares their story of success. And there's one common factor, Robert. Robert had believed in them when no one else did. He helped pay tuition for school. He spoke truth into their lives. He took time for them. He loaned money. He served and invested in other people. The story ends with saying, there's a kind of failure that's the best success. And so that's my hope for my class and for myself as we leave Fairview Christian School, that we would do hard things, that we would persevere, be found faithful, and succeed in life in the things that really matter. Thank you.
All right, it's now my privilege to say a few words about each of these people individually. We won't go too long, but hopefully it's appropriate and fitting because you guys did a lot of work and you were a great class. Daryl, thanks for speaking. There are quite a few things that have changed around here since you were a student here. Juniors don't get any ideas. Great job, Chrissy and Emily. Wonderful speeches. They worked very hard. They got great grades. And really, it should have been two valedictorians up here. They were separated by 0.12 percentage points over 4 years. So they were basically one and the same with their grades. Very, very excellent students. Very proud of each one of you. The word that comes to my mind when I think of this class is talented. We have singers and artists and athletes and people who are creative, good public speakers, intelligent minds. You have great personalities. You're very, very gifted. In many ways, this has been a dream class to teach, and it's been my privilege to be along for this ride. I thank God for the ladies of this class that were organized and kept you five men in line. Oh man, that was a blessing. Some stats for you here real quick, very rough. I think I have it right. You've answered over 10,000 high school test questions. You've spent roughly 13,000 to 15,000 hours of your life in school. You guys attended very well. You averaged less than 4 absences per person for the whole year, which is really good, I think. Your entire class grade average for all 4 years of high school was 93%. That's pretty impressive, 4 years. And I want to say to the audience tonight that everyone who graduates gets a diploma, and they look relatively the same. Sometimes the words are different, and you know maybe there's a little bit of differentiation on them. But the work that's represented by that diploma or that piece of paper is not always evident. And what I want to say tonight is that the work that is represented by the diplomas from this class is a very quality body of work by high character individuals. And so you guys earned your diplomas. You guys got wonderful grades. There was nothing shoddy going on with your work. Many of you tried your best for your whole high school career. And so I congratulate you. All right, Benji, you're first on the list here. Benji, you're organized. You have sticky notes. You have a list of things that need to be done, the dates that need to be accomplished. Underclassmen learn from that, all right? Benji was a note taker, and he would cross things off. He also wins the award for most hours spent checking his hair in the mirror. No surprise there. Steady, dependable, reliable, consistent, unselfish. Just some words that came to my mind when I thought about it. Benji, well-prepared, thoughtful, devotionals was another trademark of him. Benji, I always felt like you were someone I could count on. If there was monkey business going on, I knew you were not going to be a part of it. I got all of you a book, and I tried to figure out where your interests and mine intersected in some ways. I'm not going to go over it. I'm going to let you figure that out. But Benji, the book I got for you was The Psychology of Money by Morgan Housel. Violet, you graduated in 3 years, which is an impressive accomplishment, something I do not recommend. You worked very hard. I don't want to say you proved me wrong, but you did something that I thought was going to be really hard to do. You lots of work in the summers, lots of work in and out of school. Very, very impressive. You're determined, motivated. You're a hard worker, and you worked a lot at Weaver's Orchard, too, during that whole time frame. Well done, well done. You're a reader. You're very artistic. You also surprised everyone your freshman year at the barn party with your feistiness. Don't ask her about the boy she pulled over and put on the ground. Violet likes mysteries. Your mother told me you haven't read Sherlock Holmes yet. So I got you Volume 1, Sherlock Holmes, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, almost 1,000 pages. Hope you enjoy it as much as I did. Gibson, we enjoyed having you on the senior mission trip this year. And the way you shared your testimony over there, sang for the people. I was not there, but I was told it was a blessing to all those who heard it. If you need to know how to get to Florida, Gibson can tell you. Gibson can tell you. Do they call you Google Maps at home? No. I think the most memorable moment I have of you, Gibson, is your solo at RSC. And you sang it at the spring program. Oh, how I love Jesus. Everyone who heard it was blessed. We should have had you do it tonight. Happy birthday, by the way. You're a bird enthusiast. Your favorite bird is the cardinal. So I got you a book, Fun Facts, Pictures, all about cardinals. Hope you enjoy it. Kylie, you had perfect attendance this year, if I'm not wrong. Very, very impressive. You're bubbly, outgoing, always ready to do something, social, friendly, and quick to laugh. Artistic. I think you got the first place in the pastels competition at ISC in your junior year, which was very, very impressive. You're the best speller in your class. Did you know that? You were the best speller. You did know that. Okay, all right. Good at math. You did trig this year. Proud of you for that. You're very athletic, and you were the high school girl that is or was, I'm not sure which, the most passionate about girls basketball. And so we're going to miss that. Next year, the book I got you is the classic, The Scarlet Pimpernel. Eddie Shoup, I gave Eddie the Mr. Nice Guy Award, and he was very popular with underclassmen, everyone. Eddie always has a great smile. He's a friend to all. He's fun. He's humble. Eddie, did you ever have a bad day? A few. Well, I couldn't really tell. You're a local Olivet's legend, by the way. So, story to that. But Eddie's a local Olivet's legend. School, maybe sometimes the assignments weren't your favorite. You particularly enjoyed those Bible memories at the end of every month, I think. But you worked very hard. You enjoy space and NASA. And so I got you 8 years to the moon, a history of the Apollo missions. Emily, you're dedicated, thorough, disciplined, determined. You graduated with honors, our highest diploma. And that means you did physics and trig, and you did 2 years of Spanish, and you maintain a grade average of above 94% for all 4 years of your high school career. Very, very impressive. And I'm proud of how you challenged yourself to do that, and you worked very hard. You never took it easy, but you always tried to hold yourself to a high standard, and you never settled or compromised. You're a great volleyball player, one of the best back row players I've seen. I don't know a lot about volleyball, but you're on the floor a lot, so I'm going to call that really good. And the book I got you was A Long Way Gone, Memoirs of a Boy Soldier by Ishmael Bia. Jevin, most likely to be late for Friday morning chapel. Future employers take note. Jevin has a competitive spirit. He brought life to high school sports. He was a first team all-star at the Pocono tournament this year. He is one of the quickest students. Notice I didn't say thorough. Quickest students I've ever had at math. Very intuitive. He also did trig this year, which I made him do it. So I guess whatever. Not that you wanted to. Jevin, you personify the phrase, the ball is gold. And you were always on the ground hustling, going for every ball. You were not, pain never stopped you on the court. Let's just say that. Along with Emily, I think, well, Violet, you were here for all your years, but you skipped a grade. Jevin and Emily, you were the only ones here for all 13 years from K to 12. And the late theme in Jevin's life, I got you a Zitz comic book, a complete treasury or something like that. Yeah, you and Jeremy might have a couple things in common there. Lewis stepped up as our student council president this year, and Lewis desires to learn. He let me know that in no uncertain terms after I gave him a satisfactory grade on his report card one quarter. He said, that is not true. I desire to learn. And so ever since then, you've gotten a G or an E instead of that S, Lewis. So it does pay to talk and lobby to your teachers over those types of things. Lewis, one thing I want to bless you for is your great spirit in the midst of a disappointing ACL injury that took you out of about your whole senior year of basketball. And you just had a great spirit. I think people have told you that, but I bless you again for that. You know, it's really disappointing. You know, one of the best players on the team, and you could have been grumpy. You could have distanced from the team. You were there every game, cheering your teammates on, very proud of your testimony, even though it was the last thing you wanted to have happen to you. Excellent singer. I think I taught you how to sing bass, so you got that by the end of this year, so I'm proud of that. One of your phrases that you asked me that I'll remember is, you would often come up to me and you say, Mr. Gaiman, what do you think about so-and-so or such-and-such? And we'd often have a good conversation about it, and sometimes you told me I was wrong, and sometimes you were like, well, I'll think about it. Maybe you're right, but I'm going to miss those. And you like cars. I got you a book of supercars. Don't worry, there's not a lot of words. It's full of pictures, okay? You can look at it. You're going to be fine. Chrissy, again, talented. You can sing. You can do art. You're really good at school. You're great at volleyball. You're good at speaking. You're very caring for your friends. I don't know. You just seem to have every ability there is. It's almost not fair. You quizzed for 3 years, four, somewhere in there. And so that was a lot of work. I think that 1 year we were at ISC, you kept walking up on the stage like every 5 minutes with your name being called for some art award. I think you're one of the most awarded artists at RSC and ISC that Fairview has ever had. So very, very proud of that. You're passionate about the country of Laos. She studied the language on her own this year and was very faithful in that. All year, I didn't even worry about it. I just greened off the goal card. I didn't even look if it was done. I knew it was going to be done. You had high standards, Chrissy, as well, whatever you did. You always gave it everything you had, even if it cost you a lot. And I was really, really proud to see that this year. And I bless you for that. The book I got you is Educated by Tara Westover. I think you're going to enjoy it. And don't let your mom steal it before you're finished with it. All right, I'm going to pray for you. Then, Mr. Shirk, you're going to come up and help me present these diplomas. And then it's about all over, so. Couple more things after that, but this is the important part, right? Getting that piece of paper. Let's pray. Lord, I want to bless this class, and I want to lift them up to you and say thank you for the hard work that they've done this year and the way that they've just persevered and the good example they were to the underclassmen, the leadership that they demonstrated to the high school, the good influence that they were. And so now as they leave from Fairview, we're a little bit sad, but we're also excited to see how you're going to use them. We commit them to your care. And we pray when you come, they will all have been found faithful. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
All right, seniors. The moment has just about arrived. But before I call your name to receive your diploma, I also have the chance to leave you with some final words. And those of you who know me best know that I enjoy motivational/inspirational quotes. And I like to mix in a fair share of humor along the way. And so I want to leave you with a little bit of both tonight. The first quote I want to leave you with is from, believe it or not, Dr. Seuss. Dr. Seuss said, "Sometimes in life, you don't realize the value of a moment until it becomes a memory." So tonight, I hope that as you look back, as you begin to look back on your years at FCS, and school becomes in your mind just a distant memory, that you're able to recognize the value it had, even if sometimes in the moment you couldn't always recognize that value. Martin Luther King said, "Intelligence plus character, that is the goal of education." And so tonight I want to tell you as a group that what I appreciate most about this group is your character. And for me to recognize you in that way says a lot about who you are. Now to a little on the lighter side. Appreciate tonight because you will never have more energy, more enthusiasm, more hair, or more brain cells than you have right now. Tom Magliozzi said that. And the final one from Melanie White. Now that you've graduated, just remember, bosses don't usually accept notes from your mother. Okay. As I call your name, you can come forth to receive your diploma from Mr. Gaiman. Just remember to pause for a picture and then proceed over to the risers and wait there. After everyone has received their diploma, we will allow opportunity for those of you who would like to take a group picture to do so. Miss Emily Ann Gaiman. Miss Kylie Ann Hoover. Miss Violet Grace Lapp. Mr. Jevin Scott Martin. Mr. Benjamin Grant Nault. Mr. Lewis Scott Nault. Miss Chrissy Jo Petersheim. Mr. Edward Michael Henry Shoup. And Mr. Gibson Samuel Weaver.
You did it.
Okay, those of you who wish to take a group picture can do so at this time. Following the pictures, I will invite the parents of the graduates to come forward for a prayer.
Okay, parents, you can come forward. And we have asked Keith Gaiman, father of Emily, and Kurt Nolt, father of Lewis and Benji, to pray. So Kurt, you can pray. Pass the mic to Kurt, and when you are finished, you can end.
Okay, let's pray. Dear Lord, I want to thank you that we can be here to celebrate this class and all their hard work and achievement. I ask that you just bless them for the great encouragement that they were to this school, especially this last year. As seniors, thank you for the hard work they put into the school, and just bless them for that. Also ask that you bless them, go with them and guide them as they start the next stage of life. Lord, you know this world needs young people that love you to shine to this dark world. And I just ask that you would go with them, direct them, and bless them.
Heavenly Father, thank you for the wonderful excitement of this moment of accomplishment and seeing a new chapter of life open. We thank you for Fairview Christian School. Thank you for the blessing that it is to each one of these students, to all these homes represented. I pray that you would bless the staff and those involved at Fairview Christian School for their sacrifice and for the work that they did and the investment that they put in these lives. I pray for these young people as they walk out this door and experience new responsibilities and go new places, Lord, that you would bless them. Help them to always look to you, to have you in their life, to serve you, and to be faithful to the end. Thank you, Lord, for this wonderful evening. In Jesus' name, amen.
Felt like we had enough singing tonight, and being that I'm the director of music here, sometimes it's easier to ask for forgiveness than permission, and I haven't asked these characters to sing a song, but I'm going to ask you to. There's a mixed quartet here that will probably never sing again, honestly. After they sung, someone came to me and said, is there a chance they could come out to Ohio and sing in a full program there? And I said, I'd love to say that they would and could, but they probably will go their separate ways and never sing again, most likely. This has really been, of all the quartets and whatever music groups that have sung at school, I think this one's almost my favorite. And the song, the message of the song is what made it so powerful. So I'm not going to ask you guys, I'm going to tell you. Would you please come down here? I'll drop these mics down and just sing one verse, maybe two.
You mean John's quartet, right?
This is Jake's quartet. No. Jake and Jevin and Chrissy. I'm going to get you one more time since you're still here. Jevin as well. And I will trust that you guys will forgive me. I know I'm a glutton for spontaneity and it gets me in trouble sometimes. But this is such a beautiful song. If I can get you to do it one more time. Jevin, are you here? All right, good. Shane, are you here? Okay. And so I tell you what we're going to have to do. We got three mics. Let's
awesome
just
loud.
Okay.
You're good at it.
I believe you.
Is that different from normal?
Nope.
Are we,
okay.
Remember
how to do it? Sunday morning. Sing the whole thing. We're singing the whole thing.
Yeah.
One more time.
Sunday morning in Jerusalem, 3 days since Jesus died for our sin.
But some things happened at the tomb where he laid. He came forth when the stone rolled away. I don't serve a dead Savior. I don't have a dead faith. He's alive, and so am I, brought forth from the grave. There is victory for the claiming every day and every hour. Raised to live forevermore in resurrection power. Now I'm no longer what I used to be. My past is buried and my soul is free.
Even death can never take my lasting hope.
Heaven's mine for my Redeemer arose. I don't serve a dead Savior. I don't have a dead faith. He's alive, and so claiming every day and every hour, raised to live forevermore in resurrection power.
Hell is defeated, he's broken every chain.
Praise God, the tomb is today. I don't serve a dead Savior. I don't have a dead faith. He's alive, and so am I, brought forth from the grave. There is victory for the claiming every day and every hour, raised to live forevermore in resurrection power. There is victory for the claiming every day and every hour, raised to live forevermore in resurrection power.
That's such a beautiful song with a beautiful message. And I just felt like tonight I want everybody to hear the gospel one more time. That's why we're here. It's because of what Jesus has done for us. Fairview Christian School is Fairview Christian School because of what Jesus did for us. And I hope that all of us can experience that resurrection power tonight.
I'm gonna trade my earthly home for a better one, bright and fair. Christ left to prepare a mansion for his children in the air. I'll join him in that land where tears nor sorrows can be found. When I receive my mansion, robe and crown, mansion, robe and the crown, there love. Lord, please reserve my mansions, robe and crown. The weather there is always fair, there's sunshine day and night. No cold nor rain will fall there, for the sunshine's ever bright. I'll need no heavy garments, I'll just wrap my robe around. When I receive my mansions, robe and crown. Mansion, robe and a crown, there love always abound. Let me your throne surround. Lord, please reserve my mansion, robe and crown. My head is bowed and bloody now for the work I've tried to do. But one day I'll be rewarded with a crown so bright and new. I'll wear a smile so bright, for there'll be no cause for a frown. When I receive my mansion's robe and crown, mansion, robe and a crown, there love always abound. Let me your throne surround. Lord, please reserve my mansion's robe and crown, mansion, robe and a crown, there love always abound. Let me your throne surround. Lord, please reserve my mansion, robe and crown. Lord, please reserve my mansion, robe and crown.
Well, it's been good to be here tonight. Thoroughly enjoyed it. And we are going to miss this senior class. I tell you what, it was just a good class. We had so many good times with them. Just the whole group, so many good memories. From Eddie vandalizing my house to, Benji and Lewis, little kids coming into school. I mean, great group of kids. And they're going to be missed. They are going to be missed. And a challenge to all the underclassmen. You want to be that class. You want to be that class that the teachers say they were leaders. They led our school in a good way. And we're going to miss that group. And I hate to see you walk out the door, but we're ready for a new group. And thank you for all you gave to Fairview Christian School. I can't believe it feels like yesterday that Kurt came with three little rugrats running around the school, and he was thinking about putting them in our school, and here we stand, they're gone. And so, what a pleasure to teach these kids, and it's It's been a good night. Thank you for being here. Stand with me. We're just going to have a quick, short prayer. And we got to sing. Is it Gibson's birthday? Here we go. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. All right, there is a snack prepared in the back. Stay around and fellowship. Enjoy the evening. Let's pray. Thank you, Father, for another year. Hard to believe. Another group of graduates that are leaving the doors after some 13 years. And Lord, they've been here a while. Lord, thank you for the faithfulness of so many in their lives, and bless them as they go. And just thank you for who you are, what they've learned, and as they take it from here, may you be honored and glorified. Give us a good evening. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Thank you for coming. You're dismissed. Enjoy the evening and the fellowship. God bless.